Friends, I'm not a scholar of religions. I'm just a student of religions. Someone who became a student rather late in life, that is student of religions, late in life, after believing for many years in Karl Marx's description of religion as the opium of the masses. You know, in my student days, Marxism was the opium of my life, and I was fully intoxicated by it. Thereafter, I've been studying religions, but I must confess that my understanding of Christianity and Christian history is still very, very poor. Therefore, I want to place a disclaimer right at the beginning of my talk today. It's by no means a scholarly or academic discourse on these three great personalities whose names are mentioned in the title of my talk, Mahatma Gandhi, Saint Francis, and Pope Francis. Rather, this will be an impressionistic account of the common spiritual kinship that I see between these three revered personalities. And my talk will also be a little travelogue-ish, because it is based on my recent visits to Rome, Vatican, and Assisi. So I am going to disappoint those in the audience who have come to listen to an erudite account of Christian philosophy and practice and how I fit Mahatma Gandhi into it. Friends, I said I am not a scholar of religions, much less of Christianity, but I have never allowed the virus of my religion is superior to others infect my thinking or behavior. I believe in Hinduism, but the more I know about Hinduism, the more I'm convinced that all religions are but different paths to God realization, what Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. When my daughter was still a child, and my wife Kamakshi is here, you know, we used to take her to the Don Bosco Church, close to a house near Matunga, for Sunday morning prayers and invariably the midnight Christmas Mass. I have always had profound admiration for those Christian priests, activists, and organizations engaged in devoted service of humanity. One such priest is Archbishop Felix Machado. And it's Archbishop Felix Machado who was to have graced today's occasion. One day, about 20 years ago, I came across a book at Chetna Bookshop. It was called Jnaneshwari, Path to Liberation. Jnaneshwari, as all of you know, is a highly revered rendering of the Bhagavad Gita from original Sanskrit into popular Marathi by Sant Jnaneshwar, one of the greatest exponents of Bhakti Marg in India's medieval history. The first thing that struck me was that the book was written by a reputed Christian priest. Far more notable was the quality of scholarship and deep love of the subject that informed the book. Commending the book in his illuminating preface, Raimundo Panikkar, and Raimundo Panikkar is none other than this great spiritual light. He passed away some 3 years ago. Spanish Indian, Roman Catholic priest. Now he had written the preface to Machado's book on Jnaneshwari. And Raimundo Panikkar writes, "The entire book is carried by an inner vision of the divine, which shows that the way to God is not by despising anything of the splendor of the creatures, but only in discovering the true order of things, which require bhakti, karma, and jnana. or in Christian language, love, faith, and hope. The author's name was Felix Machado from Vasai. And we have a colleague here, Rachel, from Vasai. She knows Father Machado, a very popular figure, not of course only in Vasai, but many other places. I was quite surprised. I bought the book, read it. My surprise turned into admiration for the author. A few years later, I came to know from a very dear friend of mine, R.V. Pandit, well-known personality, a Christian, that Father Machado is his nephew and that he works at the Vatican in the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue. I developed a keen desire to meet Father Machado, and the opportunity came in 2000, when I went to Italy for the first time as a member of the delegation of former Prime Minister, respected Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji. Father Machado came to see me and I introduced him to the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister also called on Pope John Paul II at the Vatican. The next day, Father Machado took me on a guided tour of the Vatican. I was able to experience the spiritual grandeur of the greatest house of Christ in the world. What I felt there were the unique vibrations of a confluence of beauty, divinity, and the unbroken tradition of temporal organization of a great religion through the agency of the Pope. In that respect, Christianity is very unique. There is no Vatican in any other religion, and there is no Pope in any other religion. I am a Hindu by faith and culture. My faith teaches me to pray to God from every house of worship that I happen to visit. Hence, when I found myself in the sublimely beautiful Basilica of St. Peter, I offered my heartfelt prayers, and I experienced the same peace and tranquility within myself as when I visit a temple, a mosque, a gurdwara. Friends, much as I respect Christianity, there was one mental hurdle that kept me from developing a deeper respect for and understanding of Christianity. There was a mental obstacle, and that was the question of conversions, as practiced by several Christian organizations. I used to think, and I must say I still think, that their method of doing religious conversions is wrong. My views on this subject were strongly influenced by Mahatma Gandhi's own criticism of religious conversions and the means employed for it. Some of you perhaps know about Gandhiji's views on conversions. One day in early 2006, I got a call from Father Machado from the Vatican saying he would like to invite me for a consultation on the subject of conversion. The 6-day conference was called, Interreligious Reflection on Conversion, Assessing the Reality. And it was jointly organized by the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue, that's the Pope's Council for Interreligious Dialogue at the Vatican, and the Office on Interreligious Relations and Dialogue, World Council of Churches, Geneva. That's the Protestant organization. There were 40 odd participants from different parts of the world and from different religions, of course. I was invited to present a Hindu perspective. The paper I presented at this conference had a rather long, very long title. Actually, a quotation from the paper itself. And you can see what humankind offers to God Almighty is a bouquet, not a bunch of flowers of the same color. And God accepts prayers from every pure heart, irrespective of creed. May all of us get converted. It was a conference on conversion. So I said, may all of us get converted to the true, uniting, ennobling religious spirit, irrespective of which religion we belong to. I tried to explain the Indian understanding of secularism as Sarva Pantha Samabhav, equal respect, not just tolerance, but respect towards all faiths. I elaborated on the Vedic maxim, Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti. Truth is one, and the wise interpret and express it differently. This example casts a flashlight not only on the true meaning of conversion, but also on Mahatma Gandhi's relationship with Christ and Christianity. And here, friends, I would like to tell you that I gave an example, and the example was from Milly Graham Pollock's book, Gandhi, the Man. Henry Pollock and his wife Milly Graham Pollock were quite close to Gandhiji during his long life, almost 20 years in South Africa. It was Mr. Pollock, then a young lawyer and editor of a journal titled Critique, who had presented John Ruskin's book, Unto This Last. He had presented this book to Gandhiji, which had a deep influence on him, almost life-transforming influence on him. Ruskin's Lead Kindly Light was Gandhiji's favorite prayer, and it is included in this Ashram Bhajanavali of Gandhiji, a collection of devotional songs, prayers taken from all religions, which used to be recited morning and evening at his ashrams. Now, here is an interesting, please pay attention to this. Is Mr. Gandhi a Christian? A visitor once asked Milly Pollock. Miss Milly asked for further clarification whether the person who asked this question meant one who converted to Christianity or one who believed in the teaching of Christ. So the visitor emphatically told she meant former. That is, had he converted to Christianity? She was talking about him with some friends, and they were wondering that Gandhi knew Christian scriptures so well, and he was fond of quoting words of Christ frequently, and hence her friends thought he must be a Christian. Miss Milly Pollock brooded over what the visitor said was true. Mr. Gandhi frequently quoted the sayings and teachings of Jesus. The lesson of the Sermon on the Mount seemed to work constantly in his mind and was a source of guidance and inspiration to him. There was a beautiful picture of Jesus Christ that adorned the wall over his desk, and this is South Africa. There was a beautiful picture of Jesus Christ that adorned the wall over his desk. There was no picture of Buddha or Krishna or Rama in the office, but in the center of his office was the face of Christ. When asked why he did not embrace Christianity, Gandhi has said, that he had studied the scriptures of Christianity and was tremendously attracted. But eventually he came to the conclusion that there was nothing really special in the scriptures which he had not got in his own faith, that is Hinduism. And these are Gandhiji's words: to be a good Hindu also meant that I would be a good Christian. There was no need for me to join your creed to be a believer in the beauty of the teachings of Jesus or try to follow his example, Gandhiji said. Many Christian observers, notably the Anglican missionary Reverend C.F. Andrews, saw Saint Francis of Assisi in Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. The person on the far left is Reverend Andrews. There is one more person here, friends. The woman from second from the right, Mirabenne, about whom I'll tell you a little later. Andrews was a close associate of Mahatma Gandhi. Gandhiji called him Dinabandhu, friend of the helpless. Here is a description of Andrews, of an incident in Gandhiji's life to which he was a witness after a Satyagraha agitation. And I quote from Andrews: "All through the long day, I watched the behavior of the crowd and their attitude towards Mahatma Gandhi, their leader. It was there for the first time that I could understand the secret of his amazing influence with his fellow countrymen and the reason for their devotion to him. I can only describe this briefly by saying that my thoughts went back to the gospel story for an analogy. He was there in the heart of that multitude that pressed upon him. They had come to him without anything to eat, and he was busy providing for their needs. An infinite tenderness and compassion shone from his eyes, while the mothers brought their little children to him so that he might lay his hands upon them and bless them. The crowd would never leave him, even for a moment, and his presence was inexhaustible. He had no time for himself to eat or rest, while he supplied others with food, for they went on pressing upon him and he would not turn them away." Andrews continues, and I quote: "As I have often in memory looked back upon that scene and afterwards recalled many other pictures also of a similar character, I have been able from time to time to find the parallels I needed in history. Sometimes the scenes I have witnessed have reminded me of stories about the Buddha, but most often my thoughts have turned to the legends concerning Saint Francis of Assisi." Mahatma Gandhi is most nearly, of any I know, the Saint Francis of the modern age, the little brother of the poor. So, friends, Mahatma Gandhi never renounced his Hinduism, but he often declared himself a follower of Jesus Christ. I concluded my paper at the Lariano Conference on Conversions in 2006 with these words: "May all of us get converted to the uniting, ennobling religious spirit. I affirm my belief that God has created diversity and not uniformity as the essential principle of the architecture of this universe. And this is true. This is as true about the physical or material side of nature as about the social and spiritual side of man's life. Of course, there is also God-created unity that underpins the religious diversity visible on the surface. Therefore, what humankind offers to God Almighty is a bouquet and not a bunch of flowers of the same color. God accepts prayers from every pure heart, irrespective of creed. What is needed is honest and sustained dialogue between the adherents of diverse faiths living on this beautiful planet of ours, so that we can rid this world of the curse of hatred and violence in the sacred name of religion. True religious spirit unites humanity and does not divide it. It promotes universal peace, brotherhood, goodwill, and mutual trust and understanding. May all of us, therefore, get converted to that true uniting and ennobling religious spirit. Unquote. Friends, it is in that spirit of fostering interreligious harmony that I am giving this talk. You know, yesterday I tweeted about this talk, that I am giving a talk on Mahatma Gandhi, Saint Francis, Pope Francis. So I got some, you know, tweets back in reply saying, don't be a broker for Christianity. It doesn't matter, but you know, Father Machado could well be asked a similar question by fellow Christians, don't be a broker for Hinduism. Friends, here I should spend a few minutes on Saint Francis. Saint Francis preached the teachings of the Catholic Church, that the world has created good, this world was created good and beautiful by God. Saint Francis said that it is the duty of all creatures to praise God and the duty of all men to protect and enjoy nature as both the protectors, the stewards of God's creation as well as other creatures. That is, men should protect others, but men should also protect non-human creation. Now, this is precisely what Gandhiji meant by trusteeship. You know, this concept of trusteeship is very profound. It's not only a concept in the narrow economic sense that the workers are under the trusteeship of the owners. But Gandhiji writes that man is the trustee of all the non-human creatures in the world. So the concept of trusteeship he extended to the entire domain of life. And that is what Saint Francis also preached. Saint Francis is regarded as the green saint or the patron saint of ecology. Many of the stories that surround the life of Saint Francis say that he had a great love for birds, animals, and the environment in general. Here is a story. One day, while Francis was traveling with some companions, they happened upon a place in the road where birds filled the trees on either side. Francis told his companions to, quote, wait for me while I go to preach to my sisters, the birds. Unquote. The birds surrounded him, intrigued by the power of his voice, and not one of them flew away. He is often portrayed with a bird typically in his hand. Not surprisingly, one of the favorite Christian saints of Mahatma Gandhi was Saint Francis of Assisi. Mahatma Gandhi writes, I quote, Saint Francis was a true yogi in Europe. Saint Francis was a true yogi in Europe. He used to wander in the forest among reptiles, animals, birds, etc., but they never harmed him. On the contrary, they were his friends. Thousands of yogis and fakirs live in the forests of India. They move fearlessly among tigers, wolves, snakes, etc. And one never hears of their coming to any harm on that account. We are told and we believe it to be true that these yogis and fakirs keep no weapons with which to withstand these beasts. Gandhiji continues, I personally feel that when we rid ourselves of all enmity towards any living creatures, the latter also cease to regard us with hate. Compassion or love is man's greatest excellence. Without this, he cannot cultivate love of God. We come to realize in all the religions more or less clearly that compassion is the root of the higher life." Unquote. Mahatma Gandhi at another place writes, "Our Shastras teach that a man who really practices ahimsa in its fullness has the world at his feet. He so affects his surroundings that even the snakes and other venomous reptiles do him no harm. This is said to have been the experience of Saint Francis of Assisi." These are Gandhiji's words. In one of his letters to his own ashramite, Gandhiji wrote, I quote, "I am sending you a beautiful letter received from a lady living in an ashram like ours in Italy. All the workers in that ashram are women. The letter will give you some idea of the devotion and patience with which they work. Explain its contents to all the inmates of our ashram, particularly to women. Tell them at the same time about Saint Francis. Mahadev once wrote a sketch of his life for Navjivan." Mahadev is Mahadev Desai. You know, he's very devoted and scholarly secretary. He wrote a sketch of the life of Saint Francis for Navjivan. Navjivan was the publishing house that Gandhiji founded in Ahmedabad. Friends, earlier this month, both Archbishop and I were invited to participate in an international meeting for peace whose theme was The Courage to Hope, Religions and Cultures in Dialogue. It was organized by the community of Sant'Egidio, a voluntary spiritual organization inspired by Saint Francis of Assisi and dedicated to serving the poor, promoting interfaith harmony and conflict resolution. Three activities close to Gandhiji's heart and of course to the heart of Saint Francis. During my stay in Rome, I was also invited to give a talk at the Pontifical Council on Interreligious Dialogue on my book, Music of the Spinning Wheel, Mahatma Gandhi's Manifesto for the Internet Age. I gave a talk in Rome and it was organized by the Pope's Council on Interreligious Dialogue. And here are, this is the invitation for that conference. The Courage to Hope, Religions and Cultures in Dialogue. That is Father Felix Machado with one more participant at the conference. This is Didi Talwalkar. And many of you know that she is the daughter of the late Pandurang Shastri Athawale of Swadhyay movement. She was also a speaker at the conference. This is another scene from the conference. The conference was, of course, a memorable event. I presented a paper there in a session on the misuse of religion for terrorism and other types of violence. But what made this visit of mine to Italy truly unforgettable was the opportunity to have the experience of going on three pilgrimages. The first pilgrimage was, of course, the Vatican itself, to the magnificent Basilica of St. Peter. Although I had been here twice earlier, it was for the first time that I had an opportunity to meet His Holiness Pope Francis, along with other participants of the Sant'Egidio conference. My second pilgrimage was to the house in Rome where Mahatma Gandhi lived during his historic visit to Italy in December 31, 1931, and on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of his visit to Italy, that is in 1981, the community of Gandhian followers in Rome, they built a memorial. And my third pilgrimage was to Assisi, the Janmabhumi and the Tapobhumi of Saint Francis, whose name has been adopted by the Cardinal Jose Mario Bergoglio when he became the Pope in March 2013. These three pilgrimages made me think that there is a common thread of spiritual activism for pro-poor social change that binds Mahatma Gandhi, Saint Francis, and Pope Francis. And this is what I'm going to further elaborate in the rest of my talk today. Friends, some of you might wonder, which place of pilgrimage there possibly can be associated with Gandhiji's name in Rome? And you know, to illustrate this point, I must show you a photograph in my book. I should have actually shown it on the screen itself, but still. My book opens with this image of Gandhiji in a prayerful mood, and the subtitle here says, "Where he sat became a temple." Wherever he sat, that was the temple. That was Gandhiji's temple. For me, every place that Gandhiji visited or stayed in is sacred. Be it Kirti Mandir in Porbandar, where he was born, Mani Bhavan in Mumbai, Sabarmati Ashram in Ahmedabad, and his first ashram in South Africa, that is the Phoenix settlement near Durban, which I visited, Gandhi Smriti in Delhi, where he spent the last day of his life, and of course Rajghat. All these and many other places, such places in Gandhiji's life, are very, very special to me, and of course to all other devotees of Gandhi. Therefore, let me begin by sharing my experience of Gandhiji's home in Rome. Since I was going to be in Rome on Gandhi Jayanti, I wanted my talk on Mahatma Gandhi to be held on that day. However, I was informed that my host, that is the Pope's Council on Interreligious Dialogue, it was not convenient for them that day. So I decided to make Gandhi Jayanti memorable for myself by visiting the place where he lived in 1931. It was a big and very difficult experience for me, friends, because, you know, Father Machado had told me, you take this particular bus and you get down here and you'll find out where that place is. I took the right bus but got down at the wrong stop. And in many places in Italy, if you don't know Italian, you know, you have some interesting experience, and that's what I had. It took me 2 hours to find the place, but finally I was at 103 Via Massimi, in Rome, where Gandhiji stayed during his visit in December 1931. That experience made me realize that just as in ancient times, one cannot go to a place of pilgrimage without a difficult trek on foot. I could feel the sacred presence of Gandhiji in the evening tranquil air. Mahatma Gandhi visited Italy on his way back from the failed second roundtable conference in London. He knew that the London roundtable was doomed to fail. But his real purpose of undertaking an extended journey to Europe, he was there for nearly 3 months, was to broadcast his message of truth, non-violence, universal brotherhood, and a fundamental change in international economic and political systems to ensure human dignity and justice for all. This is the message that he wanted to spread across Europe. And Europe certainly was in great need of that message, because 1931, it was a period between the two horrible world wars. And against the advice of many, Gandhiji went to meet Benito Mussolini, the dictator of Italy then. He went because of his conviction that the pursuit of peace through principled dialogue, especially at a time when the dark clouds of a new world war were hovering, could not exclude anybody, not even dictators and tyrants. And which is why, you know, it became very controversial for him, you know, when he addressed a letter to Hitler. And he began the letter, "My dear brother Hitler." And to this day, you know, people question him for calling Hitler my brother. The highlight of Mahatma Gandhi's visit to Italy was his pilgrimage to the Vatican. But shockingly, the Pope refused to meet him. An indication of how far the church had moved away from the essential message of Christianity. Many of you know that the church played a very controversial role, you know, during the World War. The outward grandeur and beauty of the Vatican didn't impress Gandhiji much. But he was spellbound by a particular statue of Christ on the cross above the altar of the Sistine Chapel. The profound effect it had on the Mahatma was later described by Mirabai. You know, you saw her picture earlier. I quote Mirabai: "He remained perfectly silent, as if still in contemplation. He then said," these are Gandhiji's words, "so deep an impression that crucifix made on me that it stands out all alone in my mind, and I remember nothing else of my visit to the Vatican. I don't remember that magnificent museum, Bernini's architecture, nothing. I only remember that statue of Christ on cross." After reading these words of Mirabai, I wondered, was the Mahatma having a premonition of his own martyrdom at the hands of a fanatic 17 years later, when he stood in front of that statue at the Vatican? Friends, the Vatican press at the time scorned Gandhiji's visit. However, in 1986, see the transformation in the church. In 1986, Pope John Paul II visited India, and he visited Rajghat in Delhi. And he said, These are the words of Pope John Paul II. Today, as a pilgrim of peace, I have come here to pay homage to Mahatma Gandhi, a hero of humanity. The figure of Gandhi and the meaning of his life's work have penetrated the conscience of mankind. So one pope refused to meet Mahatma Gandhi when Mahatma Gandhi went to the Vatican. The other pope went to Rajghat to pay homage. And look at this. This photograph, friends. This is the photograph that welcomes you when you visit the office of the Pontifical Council, that is the Pope's Council on Interreligious Dialogue at the Vatican. Pope, it's of course imagination of the painter, the artist. The Pope is welcoming to the Vatican representatives, respected representatives of various faiths from across the world. And who comes first? There is a beautiful description, friends, of Gandhiji's visit to Italy by a great Italian educationist, Maria Montessori, whom Gandhiji admired immensely for her work in the area of children's education. Maria Montessori. And this is what Maria Montessori describes of what she saw during Gandhiji's visit to Italy, to Rome in 1931. I quote Montessori. His spirit is like a great energy that has the power of uniting men because it affects some inner sensitivity and draws them together. This mysterious and marvelous energy is called love. I felt this very deeply when Gandhi paid a visit to Europe and stayed a few days in Rome on his homeward voyage. During his stay in his honor, and while he sat on the floor and spun the charkha, children sat around him, serene and silent. And all the adults who attended this unforgettable reception were silent and still. It was enough to be together. It was enough to be together. There was no need for speeches. We must think about this spiritual attraction. It is the force that can save humanity. Maria Montessori writes, we must think about this silent spiritual attraction. It is the force that can save humanity, for we must learn to feel this attraction to each other instead of being merely bound by material interests. Unquote. And this was the place that she describes is the place I visited in Rome, the place where Gandhiji lived for a few days. Friends, just an aside, you saw the photograph of Mirabai earlier. There is a small aside about her. Before Gandhiji visited Italy, he spent 6 days as the guest of a great writer, Romarola, in Switzerland. And Mirabai was Madeleine Slate. She, as a young woman living in England, was going through an existential and spiritual crisis. And she heard about Romarola. She comes to France or Switzerland to meet him and explains the crisis that she was going through. So Romarola says, I advise you to go to India and meet the only living Christ there is in the world, and that is Mahatma Gandhi. So she makes a voyage all the way from England to Bombay and then to Ahmedabad to meet Gandhiji, and her life changes. She becomes Mirabel, and the rest is a fascinating, at the same time, very poignant history. Friends, from Rome itself, I wrote an article for the Indian Express, which appeared on Gandhi Jayanti. It was titled, Why Gandhi Resonates in Rome. Reflecting on Gandhi's 1931 visit to Rome and the echo of his message in Pope Francis' pronouncements. This was my article. Perhaps some of you read it. And I began by saying that Rome, the eternal city, is still as inviting as ever. But there is a certain new thinking in the air in Italy's capital, born of three factors: prolonged economic recession, political instability, and the arrival of a progressive new pope at the Vatican. The new pope, friends, has fascinated me, like millions of non-Christians around the world. You know, some have called him a poor man, poor people's pope, pope from the slums, radical pope, reformist pope, and also the unpredictable pope. Before coming to Italy, I had tweeted about a speech by Pope Francis that the whole world is now talking about. I had highlighted the close similarity between Gandhiji's rejection of economics without ethics and the Pope's flaying, Pope's criticism of the current global economic system that has put, and these are Pope's words, an idol called money, unquote, and not people at its heart. Speaking extempore to loud applause from a large crowd of unemployed youth in Sardinia, Italy. And Sardinia is a place where the unemployment rate is 50%. 50% of the people in Sardinia are today unemployed. So when he started speaking, they all shouted, work, work, work. So the Pope put aside his written speech, the prepared speech, and spoke extempore. He said, let us fight. He told the large crowd of unemployed people, let us fight against an unfair system without ethics in which money rules everything. To protect this idolatrous system, we abandon the weakest, the elderly, those who have nowhere to sleep. Even the young are abandoned and left without dignity. He says that this culture is teaching us to, you know, it's a throwaway culture. We consume something, we throw away. And that throwaway culture is now extending to what? Throwing away your parents. You know, many senior citizens in European countries, they don't live with their children. Old age homes. So when I heard this, you know, when I read this criticism of the global system and money as the new idolatry, I couldn't help recalling something that I have written in my book and what Gandhiji also writes, that mammon service is the irreconcilable opposite of God's service. the new Pope is saying the same in different ways. Friends, the new Pope has a new slogan for the Catholic Church. I'm not a Christian, but I'm really fascinated by, you know, some of the things that are happening there. And the slogan, if that's the right word to use, for the Catholic Church is a poor church for the poor. A poor church for the poor. He says that the church should be poor. Not many people like him for saying this, because as you know, the Vatican is very, very rich. You know, perhaps no one can estimate the wealth that they have. And therefore, some of you know that there was a banking scandal, you know, before he became the Pope. There were so many controversies and, you know, Father Machado told me something when we were there in Rome. He said that one day, the Pope, early morning, he got up and without telling anybody, he just went around the premises of the Pope, of the Vatican itself. And he asked the drivers, you know, how many super luxury cars are there, show me. Because he knew that many of the senior officers of the Vatican had taken to a life of luxury. And he made sure that all those were got rid of. This slogan, a poor church for the poor, emphasizes, and friends, there is a message in this for religious establishments of all denominations, including Hindu denominations. You know, many of our own MUTs establishments, there's so much wealth that this slogan emphasizes that the church would be judged not by its riches and its outward display of wealth, but by its determined reaching out to the victims of poverty, exploitation, misfortune, and consequent despair. You know, the Pope says, you know, he has a new definition for globalization. He says, today's globalization is globalization of indifference. Globalization of despair. Friends, when I read this, I said to myself that this is a new moral voice in the world, urging radical transformation as much in the internal working of the Vatican as in the unjust, unethical, and opaque economic and political systems governing the human race. And the new Pope is influencing a new thinking in Italy and elsewhere in Europe, because their leading minds are increasingly beginning to see the vacuous nature of the economic and political systems controlling the lives of the people, spreading misery and cynicism. The leading minds of Europe are today realizing the disastrous consequences of abandoning the ethical and spiritual traditions of Europe and the world. You know, the Pope has quite often said that there are so many churches in Italy. The density of churches in Italy is perhaps unsurpassed per square mile, unsurpassed anywhere in the world. But the Pope says that many of these churches are empty. What's the point in having all these beautiful churches when there are no churchgoers? In the new Pope's unconventional pronouncements, the leading minds of Europe are finding an amplification of their own desire to see religion in a fresh light, not in the discredited old practice of one faith proclaiming its superiority and exclusivity, but a new eagerness to respect and learn from all faiths. Friends, this brings me to my pilgrimage to the Vatican for a meeting with Pope Francis, His Holiness Pope Francis. I had earlier mentioned to you that I had been invited as a Hindu participant in the interfaith meet in Rome organized by the Sant'Egidio community. On the second day of the conference, all the participants were invited to the Vatican for a special address by the Pope. The Pope said, and please, I urge you to pay some attention to, it was a very, very important address. The Pope said, I thank the Sant'Egidio community for having followed tenaciously. The word tenaciously is because this was the 25th conference organized by the community of Sant'Egidio, a community inspired by Saint Francis. So he says, I thank the Sant'Egidio community for having followed tenaciously the path traced by Blessed John Paul II in the historic meeting of Assisi, that is 1986. Keep the lamp of hope lit, praying and working for peace. It was in 1986, in a world still marked by the division of opposite blocs, the Soviet bloc and the US bloc, the era of the Cold War, 1986. In a world still marked by the division of opposing blocs, and it was in that context that the Pope invited the religious leaders to pray for peace, no longer one against another, but one beside the other. Precisely in these months of 2013, this year, the Pope says, we feel that the world is in need of that spirit, the spirit of Assisi, which animated that historic meeting. Why? Because the world today is still in need of peace. And friends, some of you know that, you know, a few months ago, when the war in, you know, the US invasion of Syria was imminent, the Pope gave a call. He condemned it. And he gave a call for a day of fasting for all Christians and non-Christians to protest against the imminent war. Of course, wisdom prevailed. The war was averted, or the escalation of war was averted. And of course, efforts are now afoot to even de-escalate the civil war in Syria. The Pope made a very significant contribution. But in that meeting which I attended, the Pope continues, I quote, we can never be resigned in face of the pain of entire populations, hostages of war. More than 100,000 people have been killed in Syria. Millions have become refugees, including refugees coming to Italy. We can never be resigned in the face of the pain of entire populations, hostages of war, of misery, of exploitation. We cannot be indifferent and impotent in the face of the drama of children, families, elderly affected by violence. We cannot let terrorism imprison the heart of a few violent men to sow grief and death to so many. In a special way, we all say forcefully, continually, that there can be no religious justification for violence in whatever way it manifests itself. As leaders of the different religions, we can do very much. As leaders of the different religions, we can do very much. Peace is everybody's responsibility. To pray for peace, to work for peace. A religious leader is always a man of peace. A religious leader is always a man of peace. Because the commandment of peace is inscribed in the depth of the religious traditions we represent. The commandment of peace is inscribed in the depth of every religious tradition in the world. These were the Pope's words, you know, when he addressed us, that is the participants of the Rome conference earlier this month. Friends, this brings me to my third pilgrimage. And with that, I close my talk. the third pilgrimage to Assisi. I had heard the name of Assisi for the first time in 1986, you know, which the Pope referred in his speech. I was then a journalist at the Sunday Observer in Bombay, 1986. And when I heard, you know, when I read that speech and heard the name of Assisi, you know, it somehow fascinated me. And I wanted to know more about Saint Francis and about Assisi, the spirit of Assisi. So I had this desire to one day go to Assisi, which was not possible when I first visited Italy the second time, but this time I was determined to go there. So I asked Father Machado, you know, who had invited me for this conference. So I said, you know, when we go to Rome, can we go to Assisi this time, please? So he said, most certainly. But when we went there, after the end of the conference, Father Machado said, sorry, we can't go, because the Pope is going to Assisi on the 4th of October. You know, here I must mention, friends, Cardinal Bergoglio from Argentina, when he became Pope, he took the name of Saint Francis and became Pope Francis. And this was his first visit to Assisi after becoming Pope. So there would be such a big rush of people going there and so much security. It's not possible for us to go before the 4th. And after the 4th, I'm going back to Bombay. So you have to go on your own if you wish to. So friends, I extended my stay in Italy. First went for a day to Venice. Of course, Venice charmed me, but it also left me empty within myself. Somehow, you know, the spirit of Venice was very different from all that I had experienced earlier. So next day I went to Assisi. At the tourist office at the train station, the lady said, oh, you should have been here yesterday. You know, what a great atmosphere there was. There was more than, it's a very small town, of course, Ashokji knows, a small town on top of a mountain. There were more than 40,000 people here. And unlike other popes who came here, you know, who would just address one congregation and go back, this pope, he spent 18 hours. He went to every important place, and so many unscheduled interactions. He gave 7 speeches, all extempore. You know, and I was reading, you know, of course, I was not there on that day, so I read what appeared in the newspapers the next day. In his speeches, Pope Francis amplified 2 interrelated messages that are at the core of Franciscan philosophy, the philosophy of Saint Francis: care for the poor and peace in the world. From this city of peace, the Pope said, I repeat with the force and meekness of love, let us respect creation, let us not be instruments of destruction. Unquote. Christians and others cannot be unconcerned about those in the world who suffer in situations of poverty or other hardships, he stressed. He spent many hours with disabled children, jobless youth, and poor immigrants. Please note, you know, immigrants, you know, immigration is a big phenomenon in Europe today. And you know, I'll come to what he said about immigrants in a minute. And he sat with them for lunch, eating the same food that they are daily served by a local charity. Then he said, most of you have been stripped. You know, please listen to the words, you know, the force of the words. You know, what fascinates me is the spontaneous force of the way he speaks and what he speaks. Many of you have been stripped by this savage world that does not give employment, that does not help, that does not care if there are children in the world who are dying of hunger. The Pope expressed grief over the deaths of over 100 African migrants. Just the previous, just a few days earlier, who drowned, actually the very previous day, who drowned when their boat sank near the Italian shore the previous day. And he said, "Today is a day of tears. It's a disgrace. The world does not care about the many people fleeing slavery, hunger, fleeing in search of freedom." Unquote. Then, in what has now become the main theme of his papal pronouncements, the Pope denounced unbridled materialism that has enslaved the modern world. And here, friends, there is an episode in the life of Saint Francis. He was born in a rich family, and in his youth, he was given to all the youthful explorations and adventures. But something happened, and he completely changed himself. And one day, he disrobed himself, became completely naked, in a church, and said, I have renounced everything in the world. I offer all of myself to you, God. We know of these traditions even in India. So, referring to Saint Francis disrobing himself before God in an act of renunciation and also of solidarity with the poor. That act of disrobing himself was also an act of solidarity with the poor. That's why Saint Francis is called a saint of the poor. The new Pope urged, and I quote, "All of us must undress ourselves from this worldliness. All of us must undress ourselves from this worldliness, which is contrary to the spirit of Jesus." The Pope warned that worship of money and worldliness are the cancer of society. Worship of money and worldliness are the cancer of society, which lead us to vanity, arrogance, pride. Friends, why does Pope Francis call for change in the church and also in the world beyond? Ring authentic. To me, it rings authentic. And I think that it probably might ring authentic to many of you. Why does it ring authentic? It's because his own life in some ways embodies that change. How he has transformed himself, friends, is a fascinating story. And I read a book, Pope Francis, Untying the Knots. It's a fabulous book by Paul Valéry, which tells in a critical and non-hagiographic style. It's quite critical of the new Pope, all that happened in his past in Argentina. It was a very difficult past. Paul Valéry tells a story of how this self-confessed sinner, the new Pope, is quoted in this book as saying that I committed hundreds of errors and sins for which I seek forgiveness. So this book tells a story of how he underwent an inner transformation that enriched him spiritually, changed his worldview, made him humble, and at the same time deepened his fixity of purpose. There are many things that attract you when you get to know that the new Pope, when he became the Pope, he said no to occupying the Pope's palace at the Vatican. The Pope's palace, the place where he resides is a magnificent, is perhaps you know, as magnificent as all the things that are there in the Vatican Museum. So he said, no, I won't go there. Instead, and he said, there is room for 300 people here. I don't need all that space. And he now lives in a Spartan guest house in the Vatican. In another unprecedented tradition-breaking move, the Pope went, within days of becoming Pope, to a prison in Rome, and I saw that prison, friends, to a prison in Rome and washed the feet of 12 prisoners, including the feet of women, you know, which no Pope has ever done in the past. Not just that, amongst these 12 prisoners were 3 Muslims and atheists. No Pope in the past has touched the feet of a Muslim and kissed it. He did it, not only that, but he said, forgive me for my sins. Friends, I now quote, and I come to the end of my talk, I now quote from another book that the Pope himself co-authored with Rabbi Abraham Skorka, who has known him for over 2 decades in Argentina. And this rabbi says, I quote, he is, Pope Francis, is totally aware that he must in some sense be a revolutionary pope. He is totally aware that he must in some sense be a revolutionary pope, not only for the Catholic Church, not only for the Catholic Church, but for the whole of humanity. And this, you know, he says in the book, On Heaven and Earth, Pope Francis on Faith, Family, and the Church in the 21st Century. So a revolutionary pope. The last words, the last lines of my talk, our world of searing problems and soaring promises certainly needs many spiritual revolutionaries today, like the Pope, who is setting new rules for his church. Thank you, friends.